He murdered Britannicus, the other soldier who was going with Seneca as a possible rival. No man or woman was safe from his sexual escapades. Nero again was probably the same, but he married two men, one a youth and one an older man, kind of separately, but at the same time. He actually married his pet horse. He married the woman of his best friend, took her as his lover as well. And when she was pregnant with Nero's child, he kicked her to death while she was with child, so that having like a forced abortion would also kill his paramour. He had a passion for wild extravagance and extracted money from all sorts of people, and the imperial court was filled with murder, immorality, and crime. Now we're on the road to 64 AD, which brings us to today's topic. So this is the leader. So we can complain about political leaders all the time, but I mean, you know, we're not up against, you know, a nut job. In AD 64, the great fire of Rome occurred, and it burned for a week. There is no doubt in the minds of most historians that Nero caused it. Why did he let it burn and let it burn? Why did Nero fiddle or Rome burn? Basically because he was so crazy that he thought if he burned more than half the city, then he could rebuild it. And he's a great genius and architect, and he's an egotistical maniac. And he's going to rebuild Rome, make it more glorious than before. But in order to do that, he got to get rid of all these other buildings that are in the way. The people knew that Nero was responsible for the fire, but Nero diverted the blame onto the Christians. And they met him. And then his statistical persecution broke out. He had the Christians sewn up in the skins of wild animals and set savage hunting dogs upon them. He took other Christians and enclosed them in sacks, filled up with stones, and flung them into the Tiber River so they can drown. He had other Christians coated with pitch, like a tar, set them on posts on torches, and lighted them in the night so they could be giant human torches and flames in his garden, just so he could see better at night. The insanity of evil grew wilder and wilder. He forced Seneca, the great Roman philosopher, to commit suicide. Burrus, the great soldier, was murdered, poisoned by Nero himself, and he had a little throat ailment, and Nero made a concoction, said, "Oh, drink this, you'll feel better." Well, he won't feel anything because he's dead. And anyone who incurred Nero's wrath suffered great displeasure and was killed. His mother, Agrippina, tried to control him, and finally he turned against her. He made repeated attempts to murder her by poison, which somehow failed because after this, you wouldn't take anything from Nero. Hey, Mom, drink this. No thanks, Nero. I'll just have a lemonade instead. He caused a roof to fall of her house to collapse upon her when she was inside of it, literally weakened it and it had been sent to go off. He sent her on a mission on the sea by a boat that was set to actually break up while it was in the middle of the ocean. He shipwrecked her on purpose, and she still survived all this. Just like, you know, when Nero sent her on something, I'm going to take a life jacket just in case. Finally, he hired someone to murder his mother outright. And when he pulled the dagger on her, she just gave him, bare her wound to him and said, "Stab me here, for this is the wound that bore Nero." This is the man who killed the early Christians, who had established outright complete persecution of them. And this is the one whom the book of Revelation calls the Antichrist. John, writing in the year 90 on the island of Patmos, has the tradition of Nero Revivitus, that is, the revision of Nero, the one who comes again, and seeing what had happened to the early Christians in Rome in the year 64. Envisions a time in the future, but also present to his own situation in the 90s, of outright persecutions of the faithful. And we see this time and time again throughout the history of the church. Political power that abuses its power, or financial power that abuses its power, going after Christians. We see it in the Civil War in Spain. We see it in the Mexican uprising, the Cristeros movement in the 1920s. We see it in the French Revolution in the 1790s. Priests and bishops, religious men and women, Catholic faithful, shedding their blood for the love of Christ. And this day we meet with the first martyrs of the Church of Rome. And we rejoice. We rejoice because Nero did not meet them. They meet him. In the midst of persecution, in the midst of evil, in the midst of darkness, they still chose to love. They still chose to forgive. They still chose to be faithful to Jesus and the cross.